This show on 90.3 WHPC is brought to you by the NYCB Theater at Westbury. Welcomes Dick Fox's doo-wop extravaganza, starring the Duprees, Lou Christie, Dennis Tufano, the voice of the Buckinghams, Jay Siegel's Tokens, the Marcells, and Eddie Holman, on Sunday, September 8th at 6 p.m. More information can be found online at thetheateratwestbury.com.
The voice of Nassau Community College.
A 2019 Marconi Award finalist from the National Association of Broadcasters.
This is 90.3 WHPC.
WHPC HD Garden City.
Available anytime on your smart speaker.
And anywhere on iHeartRadio.
WHPC from the press box. My name is Rob Leonard. We're here every Monday, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., talking sports. Joining me on the phone from parts unknown is my co-host and brother. Remember the wrestler who's from parts unknown? I forgot who it was. It was a wrestler, though. Anyway, Tim Leonard's with us. Hello, Timothy. How you doing?
Greetings, brother.
You okay there?
I'm good. Okay. How are you?
Okay. I'm okay. How are you? How do we like those Mets? The best team in baseball right now. 15, out of 17 games they've won?
Yes, bro.
And one of those games they should have won, the first loss, they should have won.
Get excited, brother.
I am excited. This is hard to believe. Like 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, this team was lying for dead. Everyone was asking for Mickey Callaway's head. Everyone was saying, why Phil Regan? And also Chili Davis has been part of this, too. He's the coach there. He's also
Everybody loves Chili.
Everyone loves Chili. So this team is, unless they start to blow it right now, is on its way. And also, you know, the Braves are coming up next. I said they had to win 4-6 between the Braves and the Nationals. And so far, it's 2 out of 3.
Well, that's what they have to keep doing, brother. 2 out of 3. It bothers me a little bit when I hear overly excitable Met fans.
Well, we are. Sorry.
Sitting here and saying things like, we're on our way. Because it's a dangerous mindset, brother.
Didn't I just say that? Are you making fun of me? Tim?
What?
Are you making fun of me? I just said they're on their way. Now you're saying all Met fans would say that.
I said it's a dangerous thing, brother, because right now, let's put it this way. The Mets, it's almost like their playoffs have already started. You know, they're in a situation right now where they need to continue to play good, winning, quality baseball.
Right.
And if with everything that they've done over the last, 15-2 over 17 games, if they go and say, let's just say the Mets all of a sudden lose 7 in a row. Well, where are they now?
Well, they're back where they were.
Then they're done.
But they're not going to lose 7 in a row. They play the Braves 3 games starting tomorrow. Then 3 more games against Kansas City, who's 28 games out, 43-76 in the Central AL. So
yes.
So I'm just saying it's not happening this week.
Well, but this is what I'm talking about. I think Met fans need to guard against. Kind of getting overexcited.
Well, I'm very excited
right now the Mets haven't done anything. You know, I mean, playoff spot is still, let's face it, a playoff spot is still a month and a half away.
Sure, I know that.
You know, I don't even know what the Mets record is, but there's a good 40 games left in the season, if not more than that.
Well, right now the Mets are 61-57.
All right, so there's a good 61-57 is 118, so 62, that's, 44 games.
Yeah, okay. Well, nothing wrong with that.
See that? See, be impressed with my quick math.
Yeah.
So, in
not
those
quick enough
40...
to pick up the check, though, with you, when you're with your brother.
What a funny guy.
Thank you.
Out of those 44 games, the Mets probably need to go – they probably need about 28 wins. I mean, they need to keep playing good baseball, like I said, and they need to avoid the pitfalls. And the pitfalls are still there. You know, the bullpen is
still
horrible. A shaky
still,
entity.
It's still not good.
I mean, let's face it, the only two guys who have any kind of closing experience in Mickey Callaway's bullpen have only shown at this point that they can't do the job.
Right.
Edwin Diaz at this point has lost the closer's job.
Yes, he has.
You know, Mickey Callaway said over the weekend that he wants to keep his bullpen roles fluid. And the managers use a word like fluid when they don't know who's going to come in or who can actually get the job done for them.
I agree.
And when your two best bullpen guys, and I'm not going to go by salary because Edwin Diaz is still not a wealthy player because he's had one good season and he's still a young guy, but you traded your two of your best minor leaguers and took on the ugliness that is Robinson Cano's contract to get Edwin Diaz.
Yeah,
and over the last month and a half, Edwin Diaz has a 9 ERA.
Yep,
he has not pitched well. He keeps giving up home runs. He gave up another one yesterday. That I'm not saying the Mets would have come back against Sean Doolittle because Doolittle's one of the best relievers in baseball, and the Mets got him for 3 runs the other night. And pulled out that game. That was the game where Michael Conforto wound up shirtless at the end of the game.
Yeah.
But Sean Doolittle's a good pitcher, and if he's on the hook for one run, maybe you have a chance to scratch it out. But Diaz gave up a 2-run home run to Victor Robles in top of the 9th inning, and the Mets were done at that point.
Right. So, I agree. I think. I don't know if it's me, but is it me or is it some of the pitchers maybe staying in an inning longer now? The starters, is that?
Yeah, the starters have given the Mets more length lately.
So that helps because let's be honest, it's the bullpen has fallen apart many times this season, and if you can keep your good pitchers, which is your starting pitcher with the Mets, that might mean something.
Well, you look at it like this. The starters have been pitching better. It's all kind of cause and effect, but the starters have been pitching better for the Mets. That is, since the All-Star break, Mets starters have a 2.66 ERA, which is actually second in the majors. So they're averaging about 6 1/3 innings per start, which is actually pretty deep in a game. And especially in this day and age. But if you're looking at that to me is one of the big keys because obviously they're pitching well and they're also going deeper, which means that you have to rely on your bullpen less.
Yeah. So that's
a big key to what's going on here. But also the bullpen is pitching better. And part of that, again, it's again, cause and effect. Is if you don't have to use your bullpen as much, chances are they're going to do better because they're not overworked, they're not tired. Guys will pitch better if they're not out there every night. And plus, I don't know how many reliable guys the Mets have in the first place. So I'm not looking to compare them to the Yankees because. The Yankees obviously have a lot of guys who, if they needed to give somebody a day off, they can. The Mets don't have that luxury.
That's
because
true.
They don't have enough. They don't have enough reliable guys.
That's true.
But because the starters are giving them the extra length that they have been in the second half and pitching to such an elite ERA, all of that is coming together and making the Mets a more dangerous team. They're giving up fewer runs. They're getting a lot of clutch hitting. You know, I mean, it's ridiculous. You know, it's almost every night in the news. You hear, oh, here's, you know, the Mets rallied for this, or the Mets had to come back, and here's a clutch hit, and here's Todd Frazier hitting a 3-run bomb off of Doolittle to tie the game, and here's Conforto with an RBI to win it. You know, it's been that kind of a couple weeks span for the New York Mets, and you know, good for them. I mean, it's been exciting. There really haven't been a lot of, you know, blowout wins. It's been a lot of scrappy, like I said, clutch hitting, and they're doing what they have to do to really earn victories.
Also, think about like Saturday, the excitement of the team running out there. You know, obviously this team is starting. There's a gelling factor happen with this winning streak too. You know, the fact that they're all excited, and you know, maybe they shouldn't be. Maybe they should say, "Well, we're on our way." But you know, I don't think at this point. I think it's better to show your emotion and be out there and, you know, pulling off.
Oh, of course. I mean, you know, you want the team to obviously to be excited and to get caught up in that emotion, and you know, that's the kind of thing that can only help a team.
Sure.
And at this point, the Mets have kind of gotten into the mindset of, well, hey, if we're down two, it's not a big deal because we can come back. Because look at how many times we've done that during this streak. But at the same time, like I said, you have to maintain that. And I'm not saying the Mets have to win 8 in a row or 15 out of 17 or anything like that. But over this next month and a half down the stretch, the Mets need to win, let's say, 6 out of 10. You know, they need to play that kind of baseball. And it's not so much that, you know, you have one really good stretch during the season and you can ride that to the playoffs. Now they're in a position where if they win 6 out of 10.
Well, I'm looking at the schedule right now, brother. You got 3 against the Braves coming up, 3 against the Royals. Okay.
Right.
You know, I think they're going to destroy the Royals. The Braves, I'd be happy with 2 out of 3, but who knows?
You know what? The Royals are on the road, but, you know, you still have to win 2 out of 3. You can't.
Well, the Mets are on the road.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. The Mets, you know, they need to take advantage of bad teams, and the Royals are a bad team.
Right.
So it doesn't matter if they're on the road. They really need to win 2 out of 3.
Also, brother, then you come in with the Indians, 3 games with the Indians, and the Indians are playing well. The
good team is scrapping for a division title. Go ahead.
And then you have 3 more against the Braves at home, 3 against the Cubs, and then we go into Philly, and the Philly's playing well. You know, you can't say they're not playing well. And then it comes back
to okay. I mean,
they're over 500.
But that's not playing well. I mean, they're playing okay. They're in the wild card hunt. But this is what I'm saying. The Cubs in the wild card hunt and in the NL Central division hunt.
Well, right now they're leading.
Phillies. Yeah.
Right.
But there's a lot of teams kind of grouped together there. Philly, same thing in the wild card hunt. These are the teams. This is the Mets' direct competition. So anytime they play a team. And there are a lot of those teams in the National League because there's a whole bunch of teams that are grouped together because you have the Dodgers who are so far ahead in the West that it's ridiculous.
Right.
And you have the Braves that have a pretty decent cushion in the NL East. But every other team in the National League, it seems, is playing for a wild card spot.
Well, they're all at 500, that's why. One more thing about the Mets, Tim. You know, the last week of the season could be big time because they're playing 4 games against the Marlins, and then the last 3 games, all of this is at home, is at the Braves, is hosting the Braves. So,
ooh, see, that's not good.
That's not good.
The Marlins
good at all.
Part of that equation
yeah,
is really
I like,
good.
That's
but
good.
To be playing the Braves, I don't know, maybe at home it could help, but, well, I'm trying to think of what the Braves have. The Braves at that point of the season. They might want to take it easy on Mike Soroka, who's their rookie, who's
right.
been having a phenomenal season.
I think it depends.
He might not pitch.
I think it depends on where they stand. Yeah. You know, the Mets are 8 games behind Atlanta right now.
So, don't even think about Atlanta, brother.
I think big.
That's absurd. Well, it really is absurd. They're so far behind Atlanta that it's ridiculous to even think about Atlanta. They would have to keep going like they're going now for the rest of the season to catch Atlanta.
Well, they're playing. And, you know, let's put it this way.
44 games left. All right.
Right.
If the Mets go, 44, they probably would have to go about 26-18.
Right.
That's about that's in the realm. Well, yeah, that's about 600. So 26-18, maybe 26-27 wins to just for a wild card spot.
Right.
To catch the Braves.
Well, think about this, brother.
They would need to win 34 of those games.
The rest of the year they play the Braves 9 times. So
yeah, it's gonna be big, but figure out of those 9 games that it'll go 5-4 or 6-3.
Right.
And that's one way or the other. The Mets could go 3-6 in those games.
Right. I know that.
They're not going to catch the Braves.
No. I think possibly.
Chances are neither team is going to dominate those games. And what's vital to the Mets is that they don't get dumped in those games and wind up 2-7 in those games.
Right.
Because if they do, their playoff wish is over, or their playoff hopes are over. So you know, those games are going. Those games, like you said, those are going to be big games.
Yep.
It's nice to finish the season with the Marlins, because at that point of the season, who knows what the Marlins are going to be trotting out there? You know, they're gonna probably have prospects up. I mean, most of their teams seemingly is prospects, besides Starlin Castro and a few of the other guys, but. You know, don't be surprised if that Marlins team that finishes the season against the Mets is, you know, the same team that spent most of the season in AAA.
Yeah, I have no doubt. I mean, I think it's going to be a great end of the season. I feel bad for our friend Marie. Her son Corey has banned her from going to any more Mets games because every game Marie has gone to with Corey and her husband Rob, who we've known all our lives. The Mets have lost. So Corey yesterday banned her from going to any more Mets games. So
that is hysterical.
I think Corey should be talked to. You don't ban
Corey
your
talk.
You don't ban
Corey
your mother.
He's doing it. He's doing it for his team.
But you don't ban your mother from.
Sometimes you have to. Extreme measures are needed, brother.
You think it'd be the other way around?
Sometimes the extreme measures are needed.
Yeah, I could just see that conversation. Mom, you're not allowed to come to Mets games anymore.
There you go.
I don't know.
He's doing it for his team. I admire it.
Yeah.
I admire the wherewithal and the determination.
Yes.
To ban his mother from games.
Yeah. So
well done, Corey.
But he didn't say she couldn't watch him at home. I guess maybe.
Well, yeah.
I guess it's only if you go to the actual game. You know. So that's unfortunate. You know.
I think Marie might have to have a talk with Joe Boo or something.
I'll
do a little ceremony.
I have no idea. That might be the thing to do. Anyway, we're going to take a break right now. You're listening to From the Press Box right here on 90.3 WHPC. I'm Rob Leonard. On the phone from Parts Unknown is my co-host and brother, Tim Leonard. Tim, you're at Twitter at?
At Real Tim Leonard.
All hit music.
For all those songs radio has forgotten about, join me, Big Ed, Mondays from 10 a.m. till noon for the Good Gold Show. We'll bring back all the great hits of the 50s, 60s, 70s, and more. The sounds of doo-wop to disco, all the Motown, soul, and great rock and roll. We'll even take your requests and dedications to the Good Gold Show.
Music.
On the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC, and streaming on the iHeartRadio app.
I will fully admit that whole wheat bread is healthier than other breads, but there's a reason we have white bread. It tastes better, it has better texture, it's fluffier. Have you ever heard of a PB&J pumpernickel?
There isn't even that much of a difference, except whole wheat has more fiber. It's healthier than white bread.
I have just 3 words for you. Pastrami on rye. Drop the mic.
Have you ever had rye bread? It's disgusting. It's coarse, it's hard to chew when they have seeds. Disgusting.
Well, you've never had pastrami on rye, or you wouldn't be saying that.
Guys, what are you arguing about bread? This is a political political show.
Oh.
Join us on the Friendly Filibuster every Tuesday at 7 p.m. on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. Okay. Don't worry, we won't argue about
bread.
Tell
your friends about the Nassau Morning Madhouse. Hear what you're missing.
Check it out. Check it out.
We're talking about spoilers. There have been a lot of people taking spoilers really seriously.
Absolutely. As they should.
I've always been anti-spoil. Have you ever seen... Well, I don't want to say what it is in case someone is planning to watch it or something.
Is it
new?
Yeah, is it new?
No, I think it's pretty old. But
okay, then it's fine.
I don't want to be that guy.
But what movie?
I don't believe in spoilers, period.
But what's the movie?
Well, it's My Girl.
The movie came out in 1991. It's fine.
Oh, my...
All right.
Don't talk about movies.
The movie is 2 years older than I am.
I don't believe.
Nassau Morning Madhouse. Weekday mornings from 7 to 9.
Yeah.
On the voice of Nassau Community College.
90.3 WHPC.
The Dream Police 90.3 WHPC. Welcome back to From the Press Box. I'm Rob Leonard. Tim Leonard is on the phone. Hello, brother. Now, we were talking about the Mets as the most exciting team in baseball right now, but your New York Yankees are tied for the second best record in all of Major League Baseball. So that is something.
Yes, indeed, brother.
That is something to be said. So, you know, they played well.
Based on this logic,
yes.
This sudden logic, the Mets are the most exciting team in baseball.
Right now.
The Yankees have been the most exciting team in baseball all season then.
No, because they haven't won. They haven't won 15 out of 17. That's why.
They just won 9 in a row.
Okay, well, they won
one game more than the Mets' recent 8-game winning streak.
Yankees have last 10 games 8-2, which is actually what the Mets are actually, so.
Yeah,
but the Mets are more exciting. Let's be honest, brother.
Well, let's not get crazy. The Yankees are doing it basically with a Triple-A team at this point, with all the injuries that they have. Still, it's ridiculous what's going on. The other night, I'm trying to remember which one. I don't know if it was Friday or Saturday. I looked at the lineup, and I'll be honest, bro. I wanted to vomit.
Why is that? Are you
Mike
disappointed?
Mike Tauchman, Breivik Valera, Gio Urshela.
Aren't these on
Cameron
your minor
Maben,
league teams?
Kyle Higashioka, whose name I still can't pronounce. There's like five or six guys in the starting lineup that when the season started were in the minor leagues.
Weren't they on your minor league rotisserie league?
No, I do a National League only.
Oh, I'm sorry.
But if Aaron Boone isn't the manager of the year this year, then there's just something really wrong with baseball, because I don't know how the Yankees continue to do it. And this has been now, at this point, it's an all-season thing. You know, Giancarlo Stanton has had like 40 at-bats all season, if that.
Right.
You know, Aaron Judge still has only had about 200 at bats, and I want to talk about him in a minute because I'm still not convinced that he's 100% healthy. But you know, the Yankees, I don't know how they continue to do it. You know, yesterday Masahiro Tanaka was phenomenal, 8 shutout innings. The Yankees wound up scoring 1 run. Brett Gardner ground rule double, gets the only run of the game. And you know, Tanaka was really good. He kind of retooled his splitter a little bit at the advice of Larry Rothschild, the Yankees pitching coach. Went to the slider more and basically was unhittable. Went 7 innings without giving up a hit. Then he gave up a leadoff single, a bleeder in the ninth. So Boone brings in Chapman. But what an epic at bat with Vladimir Guerrero Jr. yesterday. 13 pitches, brother.
That's good.
And Vlad Guerrero Jr., who I don't even know if he's 21 yet, but handling everything from Chapman. Chapman threw at one point 102-mile-an-hour fastball that he just got a piece of to foul it off, stay alive. But Chapman finally gets him to ground into the double play, and it still wasn't over because then he gave up another hit. But the Blue Jays, I'll tell you what, they got a lot of sons of major league players or former major league players. And they, offensively, anyway, that's going to be a good team in a year or two. In fact, they're already a pretty good offensive team, even with all these kids who haven't even played a full season of major league ball yet.
Sure.
But you look at what's going on with the Yankees, and I don't know how to keep winning games. And it has everything to do with the offense. And for everybody who was criticizing the pitching, especially the starting rotation around the trade deadline when they had that kind of blip, they're cobbling it together. And Domingo Germán has been phenomenal this year. Even games when he'll go the other night, he went four innings where he was basically untouchable and then gave up like three or four runs in the fifth inning, gave up a couple of home runs.
Right.
But it's enough, because once the Yankees get into a team's bullpen, they're punishing bullpens.
Right.
So Domingo Germán right now is like 15-2.
That's very good.
So it's outstanding.
That's what the Mets streak is right now, 15-2.
Well, there you go. So Domingo Germán in the season has a Mets streak. I love that we're referring to it as a Mets streak. It's hysterical.
It should be, brother.
Yes, brother. But, the Yankees, they finally lost a couple of games on Friday and Saturday. So they wound up splitting the season with the Blue Jays. Friday was their first loss in August. All right. So, it's all they keep doing is what I say is you have to win series. And if you can look at it in 10 game blocks, and if you win 6 out of 10,
right,
then good things will happen. You know, it's not an easy thing to do, but good things will happen if you keep winning 6 out of 10. So,
well, the Yankees are about to play four games against Baltimore.
it's always good for what ails you, brother. The Yankees have won this year all 10 games that they played at Camden Yards.
Wow,
which is unbelievable. That's one of the reasons why Chris Davis went after Orioles manager Brandon Hyde the other night when they were having some kind of conversation, and I still don't know what Hyde said to Chris Davis, but Chris Davis wanted to go after him, or actually did try to go after him, and that was shown on national television because it happened right in the middle of the dugout. It wasn't quite Billy Martin and Reggie Jackson back in 78, I guess it was. But it wasn't good, and it was a bad look for the Orioles who were having another terrible season. But it kind of fired them up a little bit. I think they wound up winning a game the other night. Let's put it this way: I am happy as a Yankee fan when the Yankees are playing the Orioles, because they've done everything they needed to do against them this season. I don't know exactly what their record is against the Orioles, but like I said, they're 10-0 in Camden Yards this year, and whatever their record is at Yankee Stadium, I know it's not 0-5. So, chances are the Yankees are destroying the Orioles this year, and they'll do so again this week. Today is a day night doubleheader, so there's a game at 1:00. So, yeah.
The Yankees are playing well. It's just it's a different following though this year. Like you said, all the injuries and you almost expect them to fall apart a little bit, but they've been playing very well.
Well, that's why I'm saying it's always a manager's cliche when they talk about injuries as an opportunity, and that's just manager cliche BS, for lack of a better term, but. The Yankees are actually living that this season, and they're actually making it work, and that line has become the truth. Because again, Mike Tauchman, whoever heard of Mike Tauchman before this season, but the guy's hitting now, and people, Yankee fans especially, went nuts when Stanton got hurt again, and the Yankees brought Tauchman back to the major leagues instead of Clint Frazier.
Right.
People were like, well, why are we bringing this guy back? He's a scrub. He's a career minor leaguer. He hadn't done anything. You know, look at how he struggled before they sent him back down. Talkman's been unbelievable this year, like to the point in his return engagement with the Yankees, he's been so good that, as far as I'm concerned, I think he's securing himself a roster spot for next season. And that's at the expense of Brett Gardner. Because unless the Yankees re-sign Gardner, just the only reason being that he's a veteran and they want that veteran Yankee presence, you know, the guy who with CeCe gone next year will be by far the longest tenured Yankee. I don't see why the Yankees would give Brett Gardner another $8 million contract or so when Tauchman will be making $600,000 next year and giving them, you know, that kind of production. He's been really good and startlingly good. And that's both defensively and offensively. He's been outstanding defensively. Made a leaping catch over the wall in Baltimore that was unbelievable. He's bringing a lot of fire and a lot of spirit. Anytime he does something good, he goes insane. And the Yankees are starting to kind of look for it and identify with it and have a little fun with it. But he's a really fiery kind of guy, and I'm not saying he's Brett Gardner because there's only one Brett Gardner. But you know, Tauchman has brought an element to this Yankee team that he wasn't bringing earlier, and again doing it on with the glove, with the bat, and you know he's turned into a pretty vital character in what the Yankees have done recently. Like you said, the Yankees, they're playing Baltimore 4 games. Then they have a 4-game series with the Indians after that. And again, the Indians come out of, you know, they were buried behind the Twins. It was double digits and they've made that up. So the Indians obviously are playing well. And you know, they're also a team that is battling for the Central. I mean, chances are that the wild card is probably going to be one of those two teams.
Right.
But you don't want to be the wild card.
Understandable. And one thing they announced, just to jump topics here, the Yankees and the White Sox are going to be playing in Iowa at the Field of Dreams next year on August 13th. When I first heard this announced, I wasn't paying attention. I thought it was going to be just an exhibition game. Like at the beginning this is a counting game.
It's a real game.
It's a real thing. And they're going to have 8,000 seats there, which isn't a lot. That's a very strange game. I didn't even know they could put seats there.
Well, they are actually starting construction, I think it's next week. It's going to take them about a year. They have to build everything. They have to build clubhouses.
Why don't they just bring in, some gym seats or something?
Yeah, that's not going to work for a major league game.
But they're only having 8,000 people. I mean,
doesn't matter, brother. They are doing this. It's all because of the venue. It's all because they're finally going to put a stadium on the Field of Dreams field, and you know, shoeless Joe Jackson's not going to come walking out of the cornfield, but they are going to make it so that the fans can actually walk through the cornfield on their way to the seats. And I'm still not 100% sure how they're going to work this. And you know, because the cornfield goes into the field.
Right, right, right.
So how are you going to do this with the fans? I don't know if it's before the game or if they're going to be there that much, you know, if the fans are going to be coming out or going to their seats 2 hours before the game, but that's when still the players are warming up at that point. So I'm still not 100% sure how they're going to do this. I think it'll be a cool thing, but you know, it doesn't surprise me that the Yankees are involved because they always want the Yankees involved with all of this stuff. And one thing that I hadn't thought about that was pointed out by friend of the show, Christy Ackert on Twitter, was, you know, when are they going to have a League of Their Own tribute game?
Good point.
And we both know that's not happening anytime soon.
Why not?
If probably ever. That Major League Baseball's not going there.
Wow.
You know, it's not they don't necessarily want to acknowledge that. And what field would they play on? I mean, there is no field.
No, there isn't. The closest one would be Wrigley Field, but that's, you know.
in theory, but you know, the Cubs play their, you know, the Cubs play their home games there. That's not a league of their own tribute.
That's true.
The Cubs play there because that's where they play. But you know, we'll see. It's kind of cool. It's kind of an exciting thing. It's going to be a year of construction to finish the field and to set things up. It's kind of like what happened in London. I mean, that took you know, more than a month to set up everything. A lot of the stuff was in place already, obviously, where a lot of the stuff in Iowa isn't in place yet. So they didn't necessarily have to build a lot of stuff, but at least in Iowa, they'll be able to, you know, dig into the ground and anchor stuff, because they couldn't do that in London. You know, West Ham, which owns or which plays at the London Stadium, they Major League Baseball was told you can't dig into the ground to anchor stuff. So Basically, it was kind of a lot of stuff was kind of leaning against each other to stay in place. It was kind of tenuous.
It was only one game, so they.
Well, it was two games, they kind of put it together and hope for the best, and all of a sudden they found out that there's no air circulation here, so the breaking balls aren't going to move, and you know, this place was made for track and field, so they don't want air circulation because you know they don't want wind to affect any of the events where that could be an issue. But I'm kind of looking forward to it. But again, 8,000 tickets. How many of those are going to go to people with MLB connections? Probably a lot.
I'm sure
another friend of the show, Zach Hample, I'm sure he'll find a way to get a ticket because he always does. He's a very determined guy. But you know, in terms of regular people, like regular fans getting tickets to these games,
no.
Good luck.
No,
it's actually going to be a White Sox home game, so I'd be surprised if any Yankee fans wind up with tickets.
I wonder how they deal with that. 8,000 seats isn't a lot. The team has to make money from a home game.
Well, I think the White Sox will take the hit.
I'm sure there's a payment too.
Yeah, but what we're looking at though is how many season tickets. I think what the White Sox probably would wind up doing is saying, look, the game against the Yankees in Iowa is not part of your season ticket package, and you know, if you want tickets, then the White Sox probably going to have a lottery or something.
Yeah,
I don't
I'm
know
sure
how
they will.
Do
I
it.
Mean, I was pretty close to Chicago, so you know,
it's not a far drive. It's probably a couple hours or whatever, but. You know, how do you determine who goes and who doesn't? And,
yeah, well,
you know, I mean,
it's like the playoffs.
How many hotels are in the middle of Iowa like that?
I have no idea. That's another question too. Maybe that's why there's only 8,000. We're going to take a break, brother, but we have a giveaway right now. Be the first caller right now at 516-572-7440 to win a pair of tickets. This is a good one, brother, to see an evening of myth and baseball with members of the world champion 1969 Amazing Mets, including Art Chamsky, Ron Swoboda, and Ed Cranepool. This happens on Wednesday, October 16th at 8 p.m. at the NYCB Theater in Westbury. More information is available online at the theater at westbury.com. That's 516-572-7440. And you can be the first caller, you'd be the first one to get tickets.
A Super Bowl champion, U.S. congressman, publisher of Long Island Business News, award-winning authors, physical fitness, life coach, and celebrities like Billy Crystal and Eddie Murphy? I had no idea so many awesome people got their start at Nassau Community College.
Located on 225 acres in Garden City, Long Island, Nassau Community College, a member of the State University of New York system, has close to 20,000 students attend the school each year. The college mascot is Leo the Lion, and Lion Tail are his stories of the school's absolute best and brightest who have graduated over the past 50 plus years. Hosted by Aurora Workman, the president of Nassau Community College Alumni Association, and Dr. Linda Nadian, a proud Nassau graduate. Let's catch up together as the Alumni Association of Nassau Community College proudly presents Lion Tales, a Nassau Community College Foundation production. Listen every Monday afternoon at 3:30 on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Shake off the realities of the day, broaden your musical horizons, and embrace the diversity every Monday evening at 6 on Revelations. The show offers a potently unique collection of music with an emphasis on themes and rock rarities. An occasional tour de force of blues and soul mixed with compelling sets of folk and folk rock. I'm Steve Kay, and I've got the perfect soundtrack for your drive home every Monday evening at 6 on Revelations, right here on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Frank Sinatra.
Bing Crosby.
Ella Fitzgerald.
Dean Martin.
Hey guys, what are you doing?
We're making a list of artists you don't hear on the radio anymore.
Wait, I know where you can hear all of them and more.
Where?
Right here on Standard Serenade. Join me, Glenn DeMilt, for 2 hours of great songs by the great stars. Saturday afternoon at 5 on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
90.3 WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. From the press box on your radio or your listening device, iHeartRadio, the iHeartRadio app, I should say, tunein.com. Of course, it begins somewhere, and that's nccradio.org. I'm Rob Leonard. He's Tim Leonard. This show will be a podcast later on the places you find podcasts, Spreaker, iHeartRadio. It's all there. So if you want to hear it again or you missed part of it or you're just tuning in right now, that's up to you. Anyway, brother, what's next on our hit list here?
I want to just point out a couple of things that I think need pointing out baseball-wise before we move on to other topics.
Sure.
Mets-wise, J.D. Davis.
Okay.
Who, as far as I'm concerned, is by far the best trade that Brody Van Wagenen and the GM made in the offseason, has been hitting bombs. He's like, remember Big Al, the little league player, the fat little kid?
Yeah.
He hits dingers. That's been J.D. Davis the last couple of weeks.
I like it.
I'm not saying he's a fat guy, but he's hitting dingers. In the last week, 10 for 21, which is a .476 batting average, brother. 4 home runs and 8 RBIs in his last 7 games. That is the very definition of being on fire. J.D. Davis, every time he plays, he's hitting, and he's hitting bombs. So he's been a big reason why the Mets have played how they've been playing the last couple of weeks. Your boy Ahmed Rosario,
right.
The much maligned shortstop, who Mets fans keep asking me, is this all we get with this kid? He's a .250 hitter and he's not a very good defender. He was supposed to be like a top 10 prospect. Ahmed Rosario has been hitting .344 since the end of June. And that's third in the National League over that stretch, .344. He is now the Mets' new number two hitter with Robinson Cano being out possibly for the season with the torn hamstring. The other guy who has surprised me this year, because really the bullpen hasn't been good, Seth Lugo, who might wind up being the Mets' closer.
Right.
Because he's basically the only reliable / effective guy that the Mets have. Since April 22nd, which is basically all season, he's got a 1.80 ERA with 59 strikeouts and 9 walks. Now your closer, Edwin Diaz, over that same stretch has a 6.19 ERA. So Seth Lugo, again, another guy who has,
right.
has been bringing victories to Flushing. The other point that I wanted to make, Yankee-wise, and I alluded to it before, what's wrong with Aaron Judge?
You tell me.
It seems like the power has been taken out of his game. He only has hit home runs to either center field or right field this season. He only has 12 home runs this season in 228 at-bats.
All rise is not as risen as...
You could look at it and say, well, 12 home runs and 228 at-bats, that's not horrible. That's about a home run every 20 at-bats or maybe every 19 at-bats. But Aaron Hicks has 12 home runs and 221 at-bats, so it's seven at-bats less.
Right.
Mike Tauchman, who I mentioned before, also 12 home runs and 190 at-bats. Are either one of those guys Aaron Judge? No. So I'm not sure what's going on. Aaron Judge has been hitting in a two-hole now for a couple seasons. But he's kind of turning into the what used to be the prototypical two-hole guy, which was not a whole lot of power, get on base, be on base for guys to drive him in. But Aaron Judge is not that guy. Aaron Judge is a power hitter. Aaron Judge is an RBI guy. So I don't understand what – I don't know if he might still be feeling the effects of the oblique injury that he had. I can't imagine that the Yankees would have played him, though, if that was still an issue, or, you know, if they would have allowed him to come back. But to me, there's something going on there. I'm not sure what it is. And the other thing with Judge is, again, on Sunday, an umpire called him out on strikes. Strike three was a good 6 inches low. It was shin high, and Judge gets rung up, and all he said to the ump was, "That can't be a strike." Aaron Judge needs to lose it with an umpire.
Well, he seems like he's a nice guy, brother. You know,
he's too nice sometimes. He really is the second coming of Derek Jeter, and normally that would be a great thing. Because Derek Jeter on the baseball field, let's face it, he was the personification of class. He very rarely lost his cool. But there were times when it happened. And when it did, it was to make a point. Aaron Judge is regarded in that same vein. He doesn't show up umpires. He doesn't whine about stuff. He doesn't complain. But when he does, people will take notice. And the next time that this happens, Aaron Judge needs to go Brett Gardner crazy on somebody. Because it keeps happening over and over again where umpires forget that Aaron Judge is 6'7". The pitch yesterday wouldn't have been a strike to Gardner, and Gardner's like 5'11". That's how low it was. I mean, it was ridiculous if the ump was calling that a strike. But again, this has happened over and over and over this season. So, I can't imagine that the Yankees haven't brought this to the attention of Major League Baseball and say, look, this guy's 6'7". Why don't the umpires realize that? And you know, this supposed low strike that keeps getting called against him. And I'm not talking a couple of times. This has happened at least a couple dozen times this season. And it's not always on strike three, but strike three is when you get the replay and when people will point it out because now you're out. So, but they don't, they're not looking at it on a highlight reel and when saying, oh, and here Aaron Judge got banged on a third strike. It wasn't a third strike. When it happens on strike one, nobody's replaying that. But it's happening over and over again. Aaron Judge just needs to lose it. And if I'm Aaron Boone, the manager, I'm telling Aaron Judge, hey, the next time it happens, I don't care who the ump is, go off. Because that's the only way it's going to become an issue. That'll get it talked about. So
all the other umpires will start talking.
The Yankees need Aaron Judge to be Aaron Judge. That's basically what it comes down to.
Chandler, let's talk about the Jets quickly. Chandler Catanzaro.
Catanzaro. Yeah, I don't want to talk about this too much. I don't understand what this guy is doing.
I don't either.
He's a Jets kicker. They signed him because he actually used to be the Jets kicker. Then they signed him as a free agent this year because their previous kicker left for, I think it was Seattle. Catanzaro retired.
Yeah, that's so unusual.
Out of nowhere. He's 28, 29 years old. He's been having a rough camp. He missed 2 out of 3 of his extra points against the Giants in the exhibition game on Thursday. Made a 34-yard field goal, but was, like I said, 1 for 3 on extra points. And out of nowhere, just walked into Coach Gase's office and said, you know what, I'm done.
Right.
And I'm retiring, and give me the paperwork, and I'm going to go home.
I wonder if if he can change his mind, or is this his way of getting off the Jets, or, you know?
No, I mean, if he signs the paperwork, there are restrictions It's not like he can just say, oh, I'm retiring, release me, and you know, then he can go to another team. I just think that I think he really is sure of where the ball is going or what he's doing or what he has to do to fix it, and it just seems like he's not really enjoying it. Plus, by retiring and doing it now, he has to return $500,000 signing bonus.
Yeah, that's horrible. Who wants to return that?
You know, I mean, from that standpoint, it's a somewhat damaging decision for him personally, because obviously he's got to cut a check for $500,000 back to the Jets.
I would say, but, well, I'm going to stay until that $500,000 check cashes. You know,
well, that's the whole why it was such a surprise is because, you know, he could have done that and he could have just kind of, you know, played his way through the season or even just gone through preseason. And if the Jets cut him, he still gets to keep the bonus.
Right. Well,
so he could have done that, but he didn't. So I give him credit for saying, you know what, this isn't working for me and it's obviously not working for you, but we need, you know, I need to go home and I need to be done with this because it's not what I want to do anymore.
I don't blame you. The Giants won the Snoopy Bowl. I mean, like I said, these exhibition games don't mean anything to me as a fan.
No.
The only thing I worry about is someone getting hurt. A matter of fact, I think they should, you know, do a skills and competition as a way to get points instead of sending people out to get tackled and possibly get hurt, like Mark Sanchez does.
I love it when my brother tries to remake sports.
Well, like I said, I wouldn't, if I was the NFL, I know they want to make it an 18-game season, lose two of the exhibitions, but I would, you know, two of the games are at home. I'd play them outside. I'd play them outside our area, whatever your area is. You know, you play them in, you know, Mississippi or something, or Montana. Just someplace.
Too many games, too much weird travel.
Yeah, but you know, it's not fair to the season ticket holders. They get screwed. They pay for full regular season prices, or give them something for free.
But you're kind of making the point for the expanded season.
Oh, I'm for the expanded season.
The NFL players don't want the expanded.
No, they don't, and I don't blame them because it's another two games to have your head handed to you.
Right,
so,
but I agree with chances are you're getting that anyway, but you know the regular starters probably aren't playing more than a couple series during the exhibition game.
Well, Sam Darnold
played one series.
Yeah,
you know, Daniel Jones and Eli Manning played one series for the Giants in that game. So you know the obviously there's still an injury risk, but it's being minimized. You know, you're looking at guys like Joe Tanney and Kyle Lauletta are the guys that are playing the majority of the snaps for the Giants, and that'll be the case in the first, probably in the first three exhibition games,
yeah.
And then you'll see Eli Manning playing probably a half or maybe a little more than a half of the final preseason game. So if you take that part of it away. You know, I mean, right now, this portion of the NFL season, coaches are just trying to keep guys healthy. They're trying to get them some reps in game situations, but pretty much they're trying to keep them healthy.
Right, right. That's understandable.
And you know, maybe Daniel Jones will see a few more snaps in the next game because Shermer wants to see what he can do with NFL pass rushers coming at him. You know, maybe he starts a game because he wants to see him against a first-team defense instead of a second-team defense. But that, I tell you what, Daniel Jones, for all the crap he got on draft day, answered a lot of critics the other night against the Jets. And obviously, again, going against mostly a second-team defense, but 5 for 5 for, 67 yards through a touchdown in his only series. You can't do much better than that.
No, especially an exhibition game. You know, it's you know, if you're trying to get on the team, these games are important.
Of course.
If you're not on the team, or if you're already sort of, you know, on the team and you're not guaranteed the job, but it's sort of guaranteed, you know, or if you're watching it, it's, you know, just kind of boring. Brother.
I mean, there are probably 30 guys out of 53 that are fairly certain.
Right.
It's the rest of those guys. Those last 23 spots, and you're talking about 70 or so guys fighting.
Okay, brother, quickly, 5 minutes.
Yes, brother.
A couple of things. We actually, you know, you were the king of arena football reporting for many years.
Go ahead, brother. Say it. Say it. I should be in the Hall of Fame.
You should be in the Arena Football Hall of Fame. And Arena Football is actually still around. There's other leagues, but the AFL, the Arena Football League, is actually still around, as limited amount as it is. It used to be the Albany Firebirds, but now they're called the Albany Empire.
Quickly,
brother, just to hit where you used to cover.
Last night was Arena Bowl 32, and it was played in Albany, and the Albany Empire defeated the Philadelphia Soul, which is part owned by Ron Jaworski, 45-27 to give Albany its second title in Arena Football League history. The first one came in 1999, brother, and I was there.
I remember that. You called me. I was watching the game on Channel 7.
I went up to Albany for that one. Tommy Grady, the quarterback, threw 5 touchdown passes. Quentin Sims caught 4 of those. And Maurice Leggett ran an interception back from one end zone to the other for a pick six. Grady was named the game's MVP, so congratulations to him. Key sequence in the game, brother, and turnovers are always a key sequence in the Arena Football League because basically you just want to hold the serve and score. But Albany caused a fumble. They recovered. They drove for a TD. Then onside kick, which is a very surprising play. So they recovered that, and they went on to score again. They took a 35-21 lead before halftime. Now, 14 points sounds like a big lead, but in Arena Football, it really isn't.
No.
But defensively, in the third quarter, the Empire were phenomenal. They wound up in the game, not just in third quarter, but they stopped the Soul twice on downs inside the 5-yard line.
Right.
To get 2 turnovers that way. In Arena Football, if you do something like that once, that's enormous. You do it twice, it wins you games. And that's what Albany did. One of the highlights, I should say, for me, my man touchdown Eddie Brown.
You covered him.
I covered him. He was clearly one of the 2 best players in the league when I was covering the league back in the mid '90s. He and Barry Wagner were competing for scoring titles. He was the honorary captain for the Empire back in the city. That helped make him famous.
Right.
Now his son is obviously way more famous than he was.
Well, who's his son?
His son is Antonio Brown.
Oh, okay.
Who, you know, formerly of the Pittsburgh Steelers, now of the Oakland Raiders, and now of the ridiculous helmet situation where he says he might retire if they don't let him use his old helmet. Good to see Albany get another title finally after 20 years.
And Albany still draws the fans there. You know, they kicked out the Firebirds years ago because they're trying to match more NFL cities, and Albany is not considered, even though they have a 15,000 seat arena, maybe, you know, first on your list for major league cities, but they draw the teams, draw the fans.
It's a perfect Arena Football city. Yep. I don't know why they ever even thought about leaving that area.
We'll see what happens next year with the Arena League itself because it's I wouldn't say it's on its last legs.
I didn't even know until I was watching the game. There was a team in Atlantic City this year.
Yeah, so they're trying to bring back arena football. There's a National Arena League, which is in Westchester.
There's a lot of different leagues now.
They call themselves the New York Streets, which is really silly. By the way, brother, quickly on soccer, my Liverpool beat up on Norwich. On Friday, 4-1.
Just a brutal game. Terrible to watch. Man City, brother, the last year's champions.
A minute and a half, brother.
Yes, brother. Man City, last year's defending champions, destroyed West Ham 5-0 on Saturday. Hat trick for Raheem Sterling. Tottenham, one of the 3 teams that are going to be competing for the title this year, had a rally for a 3-1 win over Aston Villa, which looks surprisingly good for a just promoted team. 2 goals for my man, Harry Kane. Who allegedly doesn't score in August, but Harry Kane just told everybody he scores when he damn well wants to.
Of course.
Big result of the weekend, brother. Manchester United demolished Chelsea 4-0. Your boy Christian Pulisic, the 20-year-old American who Chelsea purchased last year for more than £60 million. I forget the exact number. Finally made his debut for Chelsea, coming on in the second half as a substitute for new manager Frank Lampard, who was a Chelsea legend, but they're already some of the fans are already starting a Lampard out campaign because of the 4-0 loss to Manchester United.
Right.
So not a good start for him, to say the least. The big match, the upcoming weekend, has Tottenham traveling to Manchester City on Saturday. That should be a good one.
Okay, well, that just about does it for our show, brother. Where can people reach you on Twitter?
At Real Tim Leonard.
Yeah, that's Tim Leonard. I'm Rob Leonard. Just a reminder, the Country Show every Sunday at 7 p.m., playing today's country music, along with interviews with the artists themselves. Hosted by up-and-coming country star Jenna Lewis. That's the Country Show every Sunday at 7 p.m. right here at 90.3 WHPC. Thank you for listening. I'll see you Friday with Beatles songs. Take care.
The views expressed on air are not necessarily those of WHPC, its management, or Nassau Community College. Responsible opposing viewpoints will be considered by emailing them to whpc@ncc.edu or by mail at WHPC 1 Education Drive, Garden City, New York, 11530. Thanks for listening to the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.